الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه كما يحب ربنا ويرضى، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. Inshallah tabarak ta'ala, tonight we'll be dealing with a very important topic. The question has come up, not only here in Newark, but also in our city, in Philadelphia and other places. And it was one of the questions that we had received, as we asked the people to give questions. And it came up in more than one question, actually. It came up in more than one question this week. So, as we had done last week, we thought we would reiterate and give some benefit with regard to the issue of the rights of custody with regards to the children. With regards to the rights of custody with children. As in many cases we find that there are those who, when they divorce, there is between them children. And the question becomes, who has rights of custody over those children? So we thought we would bring some of the narrations from some of the books of hadith, Sunan of Abi Dawood, the Jami' Imam al-Tirmidhi, and other than it, and then bring some of the explanations of the scholars as we do, usually inshallah ta'ala, and then afterwards bring some of the speech of Shaykh al-Albani, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah, and also Shaykh Salih al-Fawzan from Mulakhas al-Fiqhi, and different places inshallah ta'ala, to shed some light upon this particular issue. Firstly, coming from the Sunan of Abi Dawood, after bringing the chapter Bab Man Ahaqqu Bil Walid, and the title of the chapter is, or the title of the Bab is, who has more right to the child? Who has more right to the child? This is actually in Kitab al-Talaq. It is actually in the book of divorce, under the chapter of Man Ahaqqu Bil Walid, who has the most right to the child. And after bringing the isnad, the chain of narration, he mentions عن عبد الله ابن عمر أن امرأة قالت يا رسول الله إن ابني هذا كان بطني له وعاء ووثدي له سقاء وحجري له حواء وإن أباه طلقني وأراد أن ينتزعه مني، فقال لها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنت أحق به ما لم تنكحي. In this particular narration that is graded authentic, Imam Abi Dawood al-Sijistani, he brings the narration upon Abdullah ibn Amr that a woman came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and she said, O Messenger of Allah, indeed this is my son and my stomach was that which carried him. She's now mentioning that it was in her womb that she carried this particular boy. وَثَدْيِ لَهُ سِقَاءَ, and it was from my breast that he suckled. وَحِجْرِ لَهُ حِوَاءَ, and it was in my arms that I protected him and I carried him. It was in my arms that I protected him and I carried him. And then she goes on to mention in the narration, and indeed his father has divorced me and now he wants to take him from me. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the authentic narration here, you have more right to him as long as you do not remarry. You have more rights to him as long as you do not remarry. To bring the benefit of this particular hadith in the sharh, we'll read from Aun al-Ma'bud firstly, the sharh of the Sunan of Abi Dawood, and we'll break down some of the different meanings and the different wordings here, though we translated them for reiteration and also for more clarification. We'll give the explanation of the Shaykh in its totality, bi'idhnillah. He says, with regards to the meaning, كَانَ بَطْنِ لَهُ وِعَاءٌ أي حَال حَمْلِهِ, and she mentions that my womb was the place of carrying him, meaning at the time of her pregnancy. And then afterwards she says, وَثَدْيِ لَهُ سِقَاءٌ, And my breast was a place of suckling, meaning in the time of breastfeeding. وحجري, and it is mentioned that the hijr here, إخوان, he says, أي مكان يحويه ويحفظه ويحرسه. That the hijr here, the meaning of it is the place of which a child is carried and is protected and cared for and looked after in that particular place. ومراد الأم بذلك أنها حق به لاختصاصها بهذه الأوصاف دون الأب. And this is a very important point. Now the reason why this woman was mentioning these particular matters is because she was trying to clarify for the Prophet ﷺ that which was specific to her and not to the father. The mother is the one who carries the child in her womb. The mother is the one who suckles the child in her, on her breast. And the mother is the one who carries the child in her arms or in the infancy, meaning in that time of rifq and lean, that when the child needs that delicacy and like this, that it is the mother who does these affairs. So what this mother was trying to establish was that she had more right to this child than the father. So what the Prophet ﷺ clarified for her was indeed that she did have more right for him at that particular time. And to yahaqqu bihi ma lam tankihi. You have more right for him as long as you do not remarry. As long as you do not remarry. And we'll see from some of the kalam of Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah with regards to why this particular woman had mentioned these particular affairs, as Azim Abadi goes into some brief detail as to mention why. Because she was trying to clarify that which was specific to her, meaning the mother, as opposed to the father. She was trying to argue her point and why she wanted her child. A benefit that we can take from this before moving on is that we should not find it strange that a woman wants her child, ikhwan. When a woman, when we find in these situations, and we understand the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this matter, and that once she remarries, the father has more right to the child. There's no question with regards to this. But this is a woman, and she has from her, because of her carrying the child and suckling the child and taking care of the child in infancy, there's a bond that is drawn between the two of them. There's no question with regards to this. So we should not find it strange, ikhwan, that a woman, she has a desire to keep her child. She has a desire to want her child. It would not be natural to find a woman who just says, yeah, take him. I don't, you know, want anything to do with this child. So we see from this particular narration, from the benefits that we take from this particular narration, is that this woman was clarifying and she's arguing why she believes she had more right to her child. And so we should not find it strange, ikhwan, when a woman strives to want to keep her child. And yantazi'uhu, and he wanted to take him, meaning, and to take him from me. And the Prophet ﷺ said, anti haq bihi, you have more right to him, eh? Biwaladik, meaning with your child, ma lam tankihi, as long as you do not remarry. And this is the point. As long as you do not remarry. وقال في النيل في الحديث دليل على أن الأم أولى بالولد من الأب ما لم يحصل مانع من ذلك كالنكاح. And then he goes on to mention that in this particular narration there is a proof that the mother has more right. She takes precedence over the man with regards to the child as long as there does not come something to prevent that. As long as there does not come some circumstance to prevent that or prohibit that particular right that is given firstly to the mother. So the mother takes precedence, ikhwan, when the divorce happens with regards to the child. But if there comes along some affair, and we'll mention some of them from Sheikh Fawzan, if there comes along some matter or some affair that would give the right or take the right away from the woman, that at that particular point, then we say that she is no longer has precedence or is given the rights over the child. And from those rights, as he goes on to mention, can nikah. And from them is marriage. And from them is marriage. And that is because, and from the benefits that are taken in this matter, because the man is the head of his household. Because the man is the head of his household. And the children take the lineage of their father. So for example, we have a child, his name is Hassan ibn Malik. Hassan ibn Malik, the son of Malik. Hassan the son of Malik. He takes the lineage of his father. And the father is therefore the head of his household. He is the one who has been made responsible over his children. As the Prophet ﷺ had mentioned in the authentic narration, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ أَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ, that all of you are shepherd and all of you are responsible for your flock. And the narration that mentions the man being responsible for his household. At any rate, when the woman remarries, now she is under the protection of another man now. She's under the protection of another man. to preserve the lineage of those children, to preserve the honor of the household of the man, then those children are to be passed on to their father, as he has more right to protect them and more right to raise them honorably and nobly. As Islam comes to protect the family and it comes to protect the lineage, and as we mentioned that the father has been made the head of his household, and therefore at that particular point, when the woman comes under the household of another man and the protection of another man, then those children refer and return back to the rightful guardian. And that rightful guardian at that particular point, as the Prophet ﷺ said himself, is the father. And then he goes on to mention, لِتَقْيِيدِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِيَحَقِّيَ بِقَوْلِهِ مَا لَمْ تَنْكِعِي. And that is because the Prophet ﷺ himself specified this matter. The Prophet ﷺ himself gave a restriction with regards to this matter, and he said, as long as you do not remarry. So no one should understand now that after this particular matter has been established by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we should not understand from this matter that we have an opinion in the matter. Rather, the affair has been legislated by Allah and His Messenger. The matter has been legislated by Allah and His Messenger. And as we read many times the ayah from the book of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, وَمَا أَتَكُمْ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Whatever the Messenger gives you, take it. And whatever he forbids you, abstain from it, meaning all of it. And as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ وَمَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. And whatever I have forbidden you from, then abstain from it. So clearly the Prophet ﷺ here is legislating the matter. And he's saying clearly in this narration, without a shadow of a doubt, you have more right to your child as long as you're single, as long as you are alone, or like this. But at the time of your marrying, then you no longer have that right, and that right is passed on to the father. And then he goes on to mention, and this is the statement of Malik, Imam Malik, and the statement of the Shafi'iyya, the people of the Shafi'i Madhab al-Hanafiyya. And he says, وَقَدْ حَكَى إِبْنُ الْمُنْدِرْ الْإِجْمَاعَ عَلَيْهِ. And it has been quoted by Ibn al-Mundir, the scholar Ibn al-Mundir, that there is consensus with regards to this matter. That there is consensus with regards to this matter. And then he says, وَعَلَيْهِ قَدْ ذَهَبَ أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ إِلَىٰ أَنَّ النِّكَاحِ إِذَا كَانَ بِذِي مَحْرَمٍ لِلْمَحْضُونِ لَمْ يُبْتَلْ بِهِ حَقِّ حَضَانَتِهَا. And then he goes on to mention the statement that Abu Hanifa went to the fact or the opinion that if the woman marries someone from the lineage or from the family of the child who is a mahram for the child, that in that particular point that she wouldn't lose the rights to the keeping or the custody of the child. وَقَالَ الشَّافِعِي. But Imam al-Shafi'i mentioned, يُبْتَلْ مُطْلَقَى. But he says that her rights are taken away of custody without, unrestrictedly, yani without restriction or without question. لِأَنَّ الدَّلِيلَ لَمْ يُفَصِّلْ. Because the dalil here, this hadith or this narration, did not specify that. In other words, the narration was left general. You have more rights to أَنْتِيَ حَقْ بِهِ. You have more rights to him. مَا لَمْ تَنْكِعِي. As long as you do not remarry. There's nothing of a qaid or a something in there to restrict this narration as long as you don't remarry someone outside of the lineage or the mahram of that particular child. So in other words, Imam al-Shafi'i is refuting this position or statement of Abu Hanifa and saying rather the narration is general and therefore it is to be taken upon its general understanding. And he says, وَهُوَ ظَاهِرٌ. And it is apparent from the meaning of the narration, Imam al-Shafi'i saying, it is apparent from the meaning of the narration that the a woman has more right to the child until she remarries. In the next narration, خيرًا إن شاء الله. In the next narration, in the Sunan of Abi Dawood, قال حدثنا الحسن بن علي أخبرنا عبد الرزاق وأبو عاصم عن ابن جريج أخبرني زياد عن هلال بن أسامة أن أبا ميمونة سلمى مولى من أهل المدينة رجل صدق قال بينما أنا جالس مع أبي هريرة جاءت امرأة فارسية معها ابن لها فادعياه وقد طلقها زوجها فقالت يا أبا هريرة رطنت له بالفارسية زوجي يريد أن يذهب بابني فقال أبو هريرة استهم عليه فرطن لها بذلك فجاء زوجها فقال من يحاقني في ولدي فقال أبو هريرة اللهم إني لا أقول هذا إلا أني سمعت امرأة جاءت إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأنا قاعد عنده فقالت يا رسول الله إن زوجي يريد أن يذهب بابني وقد سقاني من بئر أبي عنبة وقد نفعني. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم استهمنا عليه. فقال زوجها من يحاكني في ولدي؟ فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا أبوك وهذه أمك فخذ بيد أيهما شئت. فأخذ بيد أمه فانطلقت به. Now this narration mentions upon the authority of Abu Maymuna Salma from the people of Medina, and it mentions that while I was sitting with Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that a woman from amongst the Persians, she came with her child, and her and her husband or her ex-husband were both laying claim to this particular child. Both her and her ex-husband were laying claim to this particular child. Is this narration in the paper? Yeah. Were both laying claim to this particular child. So she said to Abu Huraira, "Oh Abu Huraira," and she mentioned and she uttered some words in Persian. "My husband or my ex-husband, he wants to take my child from me." So Abu Huraira said, "Then draw lots for him. Then draw lots for him." And then her husband came afterwards and said, "Who is it that challenges me with regards to my child? Who is it that challenges me with regards to my child?" So Abu Huraira said, "Indeed, I say this because I heard one time a woman came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I was sitting with him, and that woman said, 'Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, indeed my husband wants to take my son from me. And indeed he gets water for me from the well of Inaba, of Abi Inaba. And he benefits me, he does chores and things like this for me.' And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, 'Draw lots for him.' And then the husband came, and the Prophet ﷺ, similar situation, and he said, 'Who is it that challenges me with regards to my child?' So the Prophet ﷺ said to the child afterwards, because they had refused at that point to draw lots. The father's like, 'Who is challenging me with regards to my child, or who questions me with regards to my child?' So the Prophet ﷺ said, 'This is your father, and that is your mother. Take the hand of whichever one you choose.' The child chose the hand of his mother, and the mother walked off with the child." From the things that we can benefit from this particular narration before reading the sharh is firstly that this narration, this particular woman was not married, as is clearly seen in this particular narration, that the woman was not married. One of the reasons that we can see that she was not married is the fact that she, matter of fact, what is one of the reasons that we can tell that she was not married in this narration? Naam. Aywa. What else? Naam, ahsan. So this clarifies, according to barakallahu feekum, that in this particular instance, in this particular hadith, there's not the question of whether or not she had remarried or not. But rather the question that comes in this particular narration is with regards to the fact that the woman is saying now that the child aids her and helps her. This also benefits us, as we'll see in a minute, that the child must have been of the age of the ability to discern and to choose which parent it wanted to go with. As Sheikh Fawzan mentions in Mulakh al-Fiqh, as we'll read, the age of 7. Inshallah tabarak wa ta'ala. In the explanation of this particular narration, and there's quite a bit, so we'll try to abridge it and bring some of the more important or pertinent benefits bi'idhnillahi tabarak wa ta'ala. Firstly, after mentioning that we said the narration is in the Sunan of Abi Dawood and is authentic, it mentions that both of them laid claim over their son. Both of them laid claim over their son. Ratanat lahu bil farisiyah. And she uttered some words in Farisiyah. And as the scholars of the language mention, whenever they say Ratana, whenever someone from the non-Arabs speaks a particular language, whether it be Persian, Abyssinian, whatever it may be, when that particular words are uttered in the Arabic language, they say Ratana. Ratana. Ra-ta-noon. Ratana. Meaning some words were uttered in another language. So she uttered some words, Bil-Farisiyah. Ratanat. And then it mentions after this, istahamma alayhi, upon the child. Upon the child, meaning to draw lots. And there's no question that the drawing of lots is a well-known and established affair in the deen of Allah ta'ala. Who can give me an example of another time when lots were drawn? From the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Huh? Ahsant. That whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would travel, he would draw lots with regards to which wife would go with him upon the expedition. That he would draw lots to see which wife would go with him upon the expedition. نعم. And then he says, after this, إِلَّا أَنِّي, meaning, because she's saying now, she's trying to bring her argument on why she wants to keep her son, because he draws من بئر أبي عنبة, because he draws water for me from the well of أبي عنبة. And then he goes on to mention, أظهرت حاجتها إلى الولد. So now she's trying to bring her proof on why she needs this child. So as we mentioned earlier, this is the benefit that we can take, that we should not find it strange when the sisters, when they want to try to keep the children, when they come up with some of these particular excuses or different reasons of why they want to keep the child. We understand this, ya ikhwan barakallahu feekum, we have something of patience and understanding and wisdom, and we understand that the women in this particular matter, that they are attached to these children and they love for these children, and therefore we shouldn't find it strange. We saw in the first narration where the woman made the excuses where she said, he has been carried in my womb, he has suckled from my breast, and he was carried in my arms in infancy. And now this particular narration where this particular woman is mentioning that he draws water for me from the well of Abi Inaba, wa nafa'ani, and he benefits me in different affairs and matters. She's bringing excuses, reasons, trying to establish why she should keep her child. So no one from amongst us should feel strange, ikhwan, that the woman is now trying to establish for herself the ability to keep her child. And then he goes on to mention afterwards to draw lots for him, A, meaning upon the child. وفيه دليل على أن القرعة تريك شرعي عند تساوي الأمرين. And this narration proves that drawing lots is an established, Islamically established proof, or is Islamically established affair when there is equality between two things. When there's equality between two things, as we mentioned, if one wants to travel, doesn't know which wife he's going to take, then he can draw lots, as we saw from the narrations of the Prophet ﷺ, or in this particular matter, as we see, the drawing of lots was taken. وَأَنَّهُ يَجُوزَ الرُّجُوعِ إِلَيْهَا كَمَا يَجُوزَ الرُّجُوعِ لَتَخْيِيرِ. And he says, so it is therefore permissible to refer back to this drawing of lots, just as it is permissible to refer back to the choice of the child. وَقَدْ قِيلَ إِنَّهُ يُقَدَّمَ التَّخْيِيرِ عَلَيْهَا. And it is said by some that the child's choice is given precedence over the drawing of the lots. وليس في حديث أبي هريرة هذا ما يدل على ذلك. But in this particular narration of Abu Huraira, there is no proof for this. Why does he say this? What else besides him declining? They did decline. We're looking in this narration as, so he is saying now that in this narration of Abu Huraira that we just mentioned, there's no proof that the choice of the child is given precedence over the drawing of lots. So my question now was, why is he saying this? What do we understand from the narration that shows us? Take your time, Michelle. Ahsant. The Prophet first, he gave the choice of drawing lots first. In this particular narration, this narration itself, there is no delia, no proof, no evidence that the drawing of lot or the takhir, the choice of the child, was given precedence over the drawing of lots. Rather, as he'll go on to mention here, inshallah ta'ala, as he says, بَلْ رُبَّمَ دَلَّ عَلَىٰ عَكْسِهِ. Rather, it points to the opposite. Perhaps it points to the opposite. لِأَنَّ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَمَرَهَا أَوَّلًا بِالْاِسْتِهَامِ. Because the Prophet ﷺ firstly gave them the option of drawing lots. He first gave them the option of drawing lots. ثُمَّ لَمَّا لَمْ يَفْعَلَ. And then once they did not do that, خَيْرَ الْوَلِدْ, then he gave the choice to the child. وَقَدْ قِيلَ إِنَّ التَّخْيِيرَ أَوْلَى لِاتِّفَاقِ الْفَاضِلَ حَدِيثِ عَلَيْهِ. And some say that the choice of the child takes precedence because of the agreement of the wordings and in the different narrations. In other words, some are saying that because of the different wordings in the narration, that the choice of the child takes precedence over the drawing of the lots. Wallahu alam. And then he goes into Meshwa Amal al Khulafa al Rashidin bihi. And also, this is what was done by the Khulafa al Rashidun. This is what was done by the Khulafa al Rashidun that rightly got it. Khalifas after the Prophet ﷺ, and they were?
Uthman and Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Tayyib. And then he goes on to mention, فَقَالَ النَّبِيِّ أي لِلْوَالِدِ. And the Prophet ﷺ said to the child, فَخُذْ بِيَدِ أَيِّهُمَا شِئْتَ. Take the hand of whichever one you choose. قَالَ الْخَطَّابِ. Khattabi says in فِي الْمَعَالَمِ. قَالَ الْخَطَّابِ says, هَذَا فِي الْغُلَامِ الَّذِي قَدْ عَقَلَ وَاسْتَغْنَ عَلَى الْحَضَانَةِ. This is the child who has reached the age of aql, of understanding, of intellect. He has the ability of tamyiz, to distinguish between matters. And he is no longer in need of the child rearing of infancy, yani the type of rearing in infancy. وَإِذَا كَانَ كَذَلِكَ خَيَّرَ بَيْنَ وَالِدَيْهِ. And if the matter is like this, then the child chooses on his own, between the two parents. The child is like this at that particular age of intellect, of understanding, of distinction, and able to distinguish between the matters. And at that particular time, if the child can do such, then he is asked which parent does the child want to go with, and the child can choose either with my mother or with my father, as we see in this particular narration, that the child chose his mother, and the mother walked off with the child. But another benefit that this narration shows us is the father said, من يحاقني في ولدي. When Abu Huraira gave this particular verdict, the man came and said, who challenges me with regards to my son? And this shows us that not only the women have this attachment to their children, but so do the fathers. So the sisters should not find it strange or unbelievable that a father wants to care for his child and rear and raise his child in a proper fashion, a noble fashion. So why is it that we believe, maybe perhaps because of the societies that we live in, or wherever it may be, that we don't understand that men also have this link to their children, or this feeling towards their children, many of them, and they want their children. So we see in this particular narration that this father felt something about this. Who is it that child? Who questions me? Who is it who's arguing with me with regards to my child, with regards to my son? Meaning he wanted his child. So this showed us a very tremendous benefit, ya ikhwan, barakallahu fikum, of the nature that the man himself also has that connection, that feeling towards his child, as we see from this companion in this particular narration. And then he goes on to mention after the mentioning of the child choosing, وَقَدْ اِخْتَلَفَ الْعُلَمَا فِي ذَلِكَ. The scholars have differed with regards to this. Now I'm going to mention a few different statements. These are differences of opinion with regards to the scholars. So I'm saying this to say that no one should understand that all of them are necessarily correct. Rather, I'm mentioning now the differences of opinion of the scholars. Some will say this, some will say that. Just to kind of clarify, Ikhwan, why are we going to read a bunch of different statements here? قال الشافعي. قال الشافعي إذا صار ابن سبع سنين أو ثمان سنين خير. But if the Imam al-Shafi'i said, if is this in the Imam al-Shafi'i said, is this, we can maybe perhaps just so they know on the internet that the I guess we should have announced it earlier, that the translation of much of this can be found on the website therighteouspath.com in the fix section. In the fifth section, and it should be at the top of the page. Isn't it? I believe it's in the fifth section, under the rights of guardianship, or who? What's the name of the rights of divorced parents upon the children? Nah. So, inshallah, tabaraka ta'ala, we refer back to that as a follow-along. We should have mentioned it earlier. Our apologies, but that would much of this of what we're mentioning is found there in the translation. Naam. Imam Shafi'i said, if the child becomes the age of 7 or 8, then it takes its choice. وَقَالَ إِسْحَاقَ وَأَبِهِ قَالَ إِسْحَاقَ. And this is also the statement of Ishaq ibn al-Rahiway. وَقَالَ أَحْمَدْ يُخَيْرْ إِذَا كَبُرَ. And Imam Ahmed said, the child chooses once it reaches the age of growing, or it becomes grown, or like this. وَقَالَ أَصْحَابَ الرَّأْ وَصُفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِ الْأُمُّ حَقُّ بِالْغُلَامِ حَتَّى يَاكُلْ وَحْدَهُ وَيَلْبِسُ وَحْدَهُ. And Imam Shafi, Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, and he was Sufyan, the son of who? Sufyan ibn Iman? Who was his father? What was his father's name? Huh? Sufyan ibn Sa'id, ikhwan. Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri. We have to go back to the tapes, ikhwan. We have to go back and review the tapes. We mentioned in the 40 hadith class the other day, not yesterday, but the last week, the importance of reviewing. We mentioned some very tremendous narrations with regards to reviewing that which you have learned. Because as we mentioned in those narrations, knowledge that is not reviewed leaves. It doesn't stick to the mind. It doesn't stay. And we mentioned that Imam al-Bukhari, that he was asked, how does one memorize? Or what is the affair of memorization? He said, repetition. And we mentioned the narration that when the scholar came out of the home, and he had memorized some narrations, and some people tried to talk to him, and he said, quiet, for I just memorized 10 hadith from Ibn Aun, and I don't want them to leave me. So review is important, Ikhwan, reviewing the tapes, going back over the notes, looking at the things over and over and over again, until these affairs become sound in the mind. They become thabit in the mind. This is very important, Ikhwan, as we're trying to learn for the purpose of amal, of working by knowledge, and there's no way of working by knowledge except that we have understanding of that particular affair. So to understand it, one should have it memorized and understood. So these affairs are easy, Ikhwan, barakallahu fikum. Many of us can remember many affairs in our lives because we have done it over or mentioned it over and over again or heard it over and over again. So we must give this similar importance to that which we're mentioning with regards to these narrations. Now, where are we at? Statement of Shafi, Sufyan al-Thawri. Now, Sufyan al-Thawri, he said that the mother has more right to the child until the child can eat on its own and dress itself. Until the child can eat on its own, meaning food besides the breastfeeding or like this, and the dressing by itself. And then he says, وَبِالْجَارِيَ حَتَّى تُحِيض. And with the girl child until she reaches the age of menstruation, until she has her first period. ثُمَّ الْأَبْ أَحَقُّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. And then after having her menses, it mentions that the father has more right to the daughter. More right amongst the two parents. وَقَالَ مَالِكُ. قَالَ إِمَامُ مَالِكُ الْأُمَّ حَقُّ بِالْجَوَارِ وَإِنْ حِضْنَ حَتَّى يَنْكِحْنَ. And then he says, Imam Malik says that the mother has more right to the girls until they reach the age of menstruation or until they marry. Or until they marry, like this. أَمَّا الْغِلْمَانِ فَهُوَ حَقُّ بِهِمْ حَتَّى يَحْتَلِمُوا. And then he says, Imam Malik says, as for the boys, then the father has more right to them until they reach the age of the wet dream, meaning the age of puberty. And then he goes on to mention, يَشْبَهْ أَنْ يَكُونَ مَنْ تَرَكَ التَّخْيِيرُ وَصَارِ إِلَىٰ أَنَّ الْأَبَ حَقْ بِالْوَلِدِ إِذَا اسْتَغْنَى عَنِ الْحَضَانَةِ إِنَّمَا ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَنَّ الْأُمْ إِنَّمَا حَظُّهَا الْحَضَانَةِ لِأَنَّهَا أَرْفَقْ بِذَلِكَ وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْتِيًا لَهُ فَإِذَا جَاوَزَ الْوَلِدُ حَدَّ الْحَضَانَةِ فَإِنَّهُ يَحْتَاجُ إِلَى الْأَدَبِ وَالْمَعَاشِ وَالْأَبُ أَبْصَرُ بِأَسْبَابِهِمَا وَأَوْقَى لَهُ مِنَ الْأُمِّ. This is a very tremendous point that Al-Khattabi says. As for those who go to the position and the opinion that the father takes precedence over the child rather than the choice going to the child, they go to that particular position because they say that the mother, her portion is the suckling of the child. Her portion is the suckling of the child and giving the child its rearing in the infancy. And that is because she is more gentle and more patient with regards to the child. And there's no question that the mother, and when the child is an infant and there's a lot of yelling and screaming and those kinds of things with the child and the changing of the diapers and what have you, that at that particular point that the woman is more patient, more gentle, more in her nature, more understanding and able to care for the child in that particular point, as he is mentioning here. And there is no question, inshallah ta'ala, with regards to that affair. But once the child reaches that particular age of habana, as he mentions here, then the child is in need of adab, of etiquette and character, and of ma'ash, of a living and being provided for. And there's no question that a father has more understanding with regards to these matters than the mother. Everyone knows as children, especially the boys, that there was nothing like someone saying, I'm going to tell your father. You know, when a child would hear the voice of the man or the father like this, there would be a different disposition as regards to the mother. There's no question with regards to this. So we understand that when it comes to this affair of adab, of giving the child the proper rearing and etiquettes, and the affair of the living that is, or the sustenance that is given to the child, then as we mentioned at that particular point, then the father at that particular point is a better, more suitable guardian at that particular point. And then it says, Wait, inshallah. We'll continue on. That was the last point that I wanted to mention from you. Much of the rest of the speech here is with regards to the Kalam of Al-Mundiri, who collects the hadith and like this. And then he goes on to mention, and again, we're still reading now from Amn al-Ma'bud. We're still reading from Amn al-Ma'bud. I mean, we started late, so I don't want to keep the people too long, but we'll try to finish, inshallah. Now, and then he goes on to mention, وَتَقَدَّمَ أَنَّ الزَّوَاجَ الْأُمِّ مُسْقِطْ لِحَقِّهَا مِنَ الْحَضَانَةِ. So he goes on to mention, it has preceded that a woman, when she marries, then this cancels her rights to the rearing and the custody of her child. And the point that should be made with regards to this, before I continue with Quran, barakallahu fikum, and this is some advice to the sisters, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to those rights that have been given to you and those that have been given against you. That in too many instances we are finding that the matter is clear, that a woman may remarry and the time has come that she has to give the child to the father. And in some instances they've asked us to call the scholars, and alhamdulillah we've called them a sheikh. We talked with Sheikh Ubaid al-Jabri, al-Allama, Sheikh Ubaid al-Jabri, with regard to this issue on more than one occasion. We asked Sheikh Rabi' ibn Hadi with regard to this matter. This matter was asked of some of the other mashaykh, besides the two that we just mentioned. And in every instance that we've asked so far, actually we called some of the other mashaykh, Sheikh Ali Nasr al-Faqihi, for example. And in every instance that we have called so far, the mashaykh have said that once the woman remarries, then the father takes his child. I have not myself personally found any instance where the affairs were equal, meaning that they were both upon the minhaj and both Muslims and all of these affairs that we'll get to inshallah in a second. I have not found yet, and we have not heard yet, that there has been another answer except that they have in every instance said that the woman, when she has remarried, then her rights have been dropped and that the child goes with the father. But the point is that even after some of these instances when the mashaykh have spoken with regards to this matter, we still find some clinging on and holding on to the children. And just as a reminder, and the reminder that benefits the believer, Allah mentions in His Quran, يَوْمْ لَا يَنْفِعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On that day when no child or any wealth will benefit you, except the one who comes to Allah with a pure heart. We have to understand that these children will not benefit us on Yawm al-Qiyamah. It won't be a benefit for you. Now I understand, we understand your feelings. We understand your love for your child. We understand the connection that you have. But Allah and His Messenger know better. And the hikmah of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes precedence with regard to this matter. So it is a must that you remember that on that day that child will not benefit you. Rather, يَوْمْ يَفِرُّ مَرُّ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. Rather, on that day a man will flee from his wife, he will flee from his children, and he'll flee from his kinfolk. You're going to be fleeing from that very child that you're now denying the haq, the rights of another person. That child that you're holding on so tight to, that you're denying the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, denying the rule of the Messenger of Allah with regard to this matter, that same child, you're going to be fleeing from that child on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And you're not going to want anything whatsoever to do with that child. Rather, as has been mentioned, nafsi, you will be concerned with your own soul. Your own soul. So we have to all remember our reckoning with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And remember that day, ya ikhwan, wa akhwat, and sisters, when no child nor any wealth will benefit you. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned clearly in the narration that three things will follow you to the grave. Your family, your wealth, and your deeds. Two of them are going to return, sisters. Those children are going to come back, and that wealth is going to come back. And the only thing that you will have with you to benefit you in that grave is your deeds. So if Allah has commanded you and His Messenger has commanded you to give these children to their fathers, then obey Allah and His Messenger. Obey Allah and His Messenger. And do not give yourself precedence over the book of Allah and over the statement of the Messenger of Allah. For indeed in that which is in the Kitab and the Sunnah, has given life to us. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawzi, in this regard, in the book Zad al-Ma'ad, has brought many benefits. And as Sheikh al-Albani himself mentioned, that if anyone wants to really go into in-depth detail with regard to this issue, then he should refer back to Zad al-Ma'ad, as there is much speech and kalam that came from Ibn Qayyim with regard to this matter. But we'll try to read something brief of what was quoted by Imam al-Albani, what he brought from the speech of Ibn Qayyim to establish that which we had mentioned previously. And he says, وَقَوْلُهَا كَانَ بَطْنِي لَهُ وِعَاءٌ. And now he's mentioning the narration that we previously mentioned from the Sunan of Abi Dawood, where the woman tried to establish those affairs of why she had the rights to the child, that her womb carried the child, that her breast suckled the child, and that her arms carried that particular child. إِدْلَا مِنْهَا وَتَوَصُلْ إِلَىٰ إِخْتِصَاصِهَا بِهِ كَمْ إِخْتَصَّ بِهَا فِي هَذِي الْمَوَاتِنَ الثَّلَاثَةَ وَالْأَبْ لَمْ يُشَارِكْهَا فِي ذَلِكَ. And then he goes on to mention, in this particular narration, there's a pointing that the woman was trying to establish what is specific to her, what was specific to the women in these three matters, as we mentioned, of which the father has no portion in. As the father has no portion in these matters. فَنَبَّهَتْ فِي هَذِي الْإِخْتِصَاصِ عَلَى الْإِخْتِصَاصِ الَّذِي طَلَبَتْهُ بِاسْتِفْتَاءِ وَالْمُخَاصَمَةِ. So she is bringing attention to those things that are specific to her in her argument. She's establishing proof for her argument. And this is a noble affair. She didn't just come emotionally. She came establishing affairs that point to why she believes she should have more right to the child over the father. And this points and proves us, Ya Ikhwan, that there's no question that when one wants to establish an argument, that he should bring his proofs and evidences and his qara'in, his matters and facts that go towards his affairs. So when one comes in a matter of custody, or when one comes in a matter of wealth or money or whatever it may be, then one should come with their affairs and their matters well organized and well established. And then he goes on to mention after this, وَهَذَا الْوَصْفَ الَّذِي أَدَّلَّتْ بِهِ الْمَرْأَةَ وَجَعَلَتْهُ سَبَبًا لِتَعْلِيكَ الْحُكُمْ بِهِ قَدْ كَرَّرْهُ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم وَرَتَّبَ عَلَيْهِ أَثْرُهُ. And the brother, and then he goes on to mention that these things that the woman pointed to and made as a excuse or a reason for the ruling going in that direction, the Prophet ﷺ agreed to that. He was in agreement with that which she had mentioned, and he said to her that you have more right to the child. And then he goes on to mention, وَدَلَّ الْحَدِيثَ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ إِذَ افْتَرَقَ الْأَبَوَانِ وَبَيْنَهُمَا وَلِدٌ. This is Ibn Qayyim again, that this hadith points to the fact that if two parents separate and they split up, and there's between them a child, فَالْأُمَّ حَقُّ بِهِ مِنَ الْأَبْ, that the father has more right to the child as long as she does not remarry. مَا لَمْ يَكُمْ بِالْأُمْ مَا يَمْنَعُ تَقْدِيمَهَا. And then he says, as long as the mother does not do that which will remove her being given precedence. Which, as we mentioned, for example, over and over again, is from the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, مَا لَمْ تَنْكِحِ, as long as you do not remarry. And now mentioning some of the speech of Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan with regards to this matter, and we'll read briefly, and inshallah ta'ala next week we'll continue and finish up the entire chapter of Sheikh Fawzan. It's pretty long, it's quite a bit of information. But I wanted to mention, starting with the Bab fi Mawani al-Hadana, the chapter in those things that negate the custody of a child, or take away the custody of a child. Sheikh Fawzan mentions, after mentioning the first affair, he says, وَلَا حَضَانَ لِفَاسِقْ لِأَنَّهُ لَا يُوثَقُ بِهِ فِيهَا وَفِي بِقَاءِ الْمَحْضُونِ عِنْدَهُ ضَرٌّ عَلَيْهِ لِأَنَّهُ يَسِيءُ تَرْبِيَتَهُ وَيُنَشِّئَهُ عَلَىٰ تَرِيقَتِهِ. And this is a very beautiful point, that the first issue is that there is no custody for a fasiq. There is no custody for a fasiq, an open sinner, a person who has been tested and tried with disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this falls under also the category of the innovators, Ya Ikhwan, barakallahu feekum, that in this particular matter, if the child is to be given to one of the two parents, if one of those parents is a fasiq, so now, for example, the mother and father split up. The woman is an open sinner, an open fasiq, an open, drinker or whatever it may be, in these particular affairs, fornicator or whatever it may be. Then that particular matter, even though the narration mentions that the rights go to the mother, if she's an open fasiq, then she does not have rights toward that child. And at that instance, the child will refer back to the father at that particular time. And so it is that if the woman remarries and the father is a fasiq, an open sinner, then there's no hadana for him. Why is this? As Sheikh Fawzan goes on to mention, because with the child remaining in the care of this fasiq, there is the fear of the child being harmed. There is the fear of the child being harmed, and that the child will be reared and raised upon that person's way. This is clear. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned that all of you are a shepherd and all of you are responsible for your flock. And as the other narration, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that all of the children are born upon the fitrah. And that it is the parents who either make them Christians or Jews or Majus or the Magians. So therefore, it is the parents who have this particular ability in the rearing of their child, that if they are from the people of fisk, of sin and transgression against Allah Ta'ala, that we are fearful that in that particular matter, that they will raise their child upon that particular way and cause them to be corrupt. And he says, وَلَا حَضَانَ لِكَافِرْ عَلَى مُسْلِمٍ. And there is no custody for a disbeliever over a Muslim. There is no custody to the disbeliever over the Muslim. لِأَنَّهُ أَوْلَى بِعَدْمِ الْاِسْتِحْقَاقِ مِنَ الْفَاسِقِ. Because if we're not even going to give the child to a fasiq, then we're not going to give it to a disbeliever for all the more reason. We're not going to give it to the disbeliever for all the more reason. And then he goes on to say, لِأَنَّ ضَرَرَهُ أَكْثَرُ. Because the harm of the disbeliever is worse than the harm of the fasiq. فَإِنُّهُ يُفْتِنُ الْمَحْضُونَ فِي دِينِهِ وَيُخْرِجُهُ مِنْ الْإِسْلَامِ بِتَعْلِيمِهِ الْقُفَرِ وَتَرْبِيَتِهِ عَلَيْهِ. And that is because he will be a fitna, a trial upon that child, and a calamity upon that child and his religion, and will excommunicate him from the religion of Al-Islam by teaching him the affairs of kufr, the affairs of disbelief, and the rearing that particular child upon disbelief. And then afterwards he mentions, وَلَا حَضَانَ لِمُزَوَّجَ بِأَجْنَبِي مِنْ مَحْضُونَ. And there is no custody for the woman who remarries someone from outside of the family of the child. As we mentioned earlier, this is from the statement of that we had mentioned and quoted from who? Abu Hanifa. And Imam Shafi, as we mentioned the statement of Imam Shafi'i and that which he had mentioned. And then he says, لِقَوْلِ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِوَالِدَ وَالِدِ سَتِفَلْ أَنْتِ حَقُّ بِي مَا لَمْ تَنْكِعِي. And this is from the statement the Prophet ﷺ said to the woman, the mother of the child, you have more rights to him as long as you do not remarry. لِأَنَّ الزَّوْجِ لِيَمْلِكُ مَنَافِعَهَا. Because the father, in this particular instance, he possesses the ability to care for that particular child. يَسْتَحِقُّ مَنَعَهَا مِنَ الْحَضَانَةِ. And he has the right to prohibit or prevent her from the rearing and the raising of that particular child. But the Shaykh Fawzan goes on to mention afterwards, فَإِنْ زَالَ أَحَدُ هَذِي الْمَوَانِعِ. But if any one of these things that prevent the woman from, or the parent from taking the child, if one of them no longer exists or ceases to exist, then at that particular point the child goes back to the mother. For example, he says, إِذَا تَابَ الْفَاسِقِ. If the fasiq repents, if the sinner repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, clear repentance, with those affairs of repentance and those conditions of repentance, then the child goes back at that particular point. وَأَسْلَمْ الْكَافِرِ. And if the disbeliever accepts al-Islam, then at that particular time, the rights are referred. وَطُلِّقَتْ الْمُزَوَّجَةِ. And if the woman who is married is divorced, if the woman who is married is divorced, then at that particular time also, then the child will refer back to the mother from the statement of the Prophet, أَنْتِ يَحَقُّ بِهِ مَا لَمْ تَنْكِحِ. You have more rights than as long as you do not marry. So therefore, these are the statements that the Shaykh had mentioned, Shaykh Fawzan, حفظه الله, from ملخص الفقه. Inshallah, we'll continue next week with this particular lesson, inshallah ta'ala, and the finishing speech from that. If we have any questions from the brothers, let me look at the ones from Power Talk as the brothers collect their thoughts and questions, inshallah ta'ala. Oh, there was a point that I almost forgot to mention, and I'm glad I just thought of it. Actually, one of the questions reminded me that when we asked Sheikh Ali Nasir al-Faqihi with regards to the new husband who is now married the woman, should he enter himself into this matter and basically deal with the father and take the child to the father, whatever it may be. And Sheikh Ali Nasr al-Faqih, he said, he doesn't have any entry into this matter. He doesn't enter into this affair. It is not his concern. Rather, this matters between the father of that child and the mother of that child. It matters between the father of that child and the mother of that child. And some of the brothers, the masjid in Sunan Nabawi in Germantown, they had mentioned that they spoke to Sheikh Ubaid, I believe it was a week ago. And Sheikh Ubaid had mentioned also that the new husband should not enter into the matter. Rather, even if there's a matter that has to be someone to go between the father and the mother, then let someone else from the community or the family or whatever it may be, let them deal between the mother and the father. Let the new husband stay out of the matter. And this is what Sheikh Ali Nasr mentioned also, that he has no dakhl, he has no entry into this matter. This is an affair between the mother of that child and the father of that child. So this is an advice firstly to the brothers to stay out of the matter if there are children in the affair, and for the sisters to try to keep their husbands out of the matter, and if it's possible, then let the community aid in that particular affair. Of course. The one question here is, what age is a child? The age of 7. Inshallah, we'll read that next week from Malakhs al-Fiqh from Sheikh Fawzan, inshallah. As we mentioned from, I believe it was Shafi'i, 7 or 8 years of age. Is it Shafi'i? Yeah. Many of the questions were answered during the class. Is it permissible for the divorced parents to agree that the child will remain with the mother even after she remarries? Yes, I think I... Did I read that? That must be in Lakhs al-Fiqh. Inshallah, we'll read that next week. Yeah, visitation we'll discuss next week also. As far as communication, as we mentioned, they should communicate through a third party, someone to be intermediate between them from the community or from the family of the husband or the wife or like this. All right, we'll take anything from the floor. Most of these questions were answered. We shouldn't say anything. This is a question that when I called, I was supposed to ask that question, and it wasn't asked, so we'll refrain from answering that until we ask them. So give me letters about the time. Long of us. Mother keeps the child. Speaking an issue also I want to mention with regards to the issue of the courts. If I'm not mistaken, I want to check, but from what the brothers have mentioned to me, that one of the first advices that Sheikh Ubaid had given, Abu Karim, did they give you the information on this? And one of the first advices that he had given was to keep this affair out of the courts. I'm not mistaken, that was one of the first advices that the Sheikh had given. Take the affair out of the courts, first of all, because I believe these two people, their favors in the courts were like this, is to take the matter out of the courts, firstly. And to deal with it, inshallah ta'ala, ikhwan, according to the kitab and the sunnah, inshallah ta'ala. As a reminder, take this affair out of the courts. this matter of saying that the courts gave me custody. I didn't give you anything. It's Allah and His Messenger who legislated this matter. My brother, for nothing. Equity between the two parties, inshallah. We come to an agreement with regards to. Okay. Back to the mother. Back to the mother. Was there any questions from over to the sisters? No, not in every instance. That's not necessarily true. Many of us have seen children who were raised by parents, and sometimes the father is a very gentle person with his children, very loving, very affectionate, very caring, and takes very good care of their children. And sometimes the child will give precedence to their fathers. You heard the old saying, daddy's girl. It's not always necessarily true, actually, that the child is going to always choose their mother. No off-the-topic questions, inshallah. There you are. Yeah, that one. Now, the brother asked the question. Since the mashaykh have advised that the new husband, he stays out of the matter. The brother asking, does this also mean, for example, that he shouldn't advise, or should he advise, what should he do with regards to advising his wife to fearing Allah and giving up the children? I don't think that is what is meant by staying out of the matter. I believe what is being said out of the matter is dealing with regards to the custody of the child and like this. As regards to reminding his wife to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to remind her of the rights that Allah has given to the father at that particular point, inshallah, this is a reminder, inshallah, the reminder benefits to believe in the deen is nasiha. But one of the things that we should remember is that there has actually happened problems between the fathers and the new husbands. Real problems that have taken place. And there's a hikmah, there's a great wisdom in the new husband staying out of the matter. There's a wisdom in it. Please make dua for us sisters that Allah Azza wa Jal gives us sabr in regards to these classes because we are very disadvantaged. Whenever you ask a question, the brothers answer and you say good, but we can't hear the answers over the mic. Please keep in mind that we are over here also. We would like to get full understanding of these classes as well.